Hello everyone, I think from now on I'm only going to make videos in my pyjamas. I'm considerably calmer than I was the last time I filmed a video on here. I think I have settled into it like a big old house settling. Like there are still cracks every time I do settle, but in general it seems far more normal. It's amazing how quickly we can adapt to things. As most of you know, I lost my dad when I was 19 years old. I'm 28 now. It was earlier than many, if not most, of my friends had lost a parent or a parental figure. And so in my head, as I'm 28 now, I've been sort of preparing, and I have been for the past few years, of like what I'll do and say to and for my friends, or for and to my friends, when the time comes for their parents or other people who are very close to them pass away. Because I know that that's more and more likely, obviously, as we're getting older, more and more of my peers are sort of in that bracket. And so this has been on my mind for a while, and I've said, I think, quite a lot of times that I've been wanting to make a video about books that really helped me about grief that you may not have heard of. Then, of course, a global pandemic happened. One of the things that I'm seeing already that is really heartbreaking is that a lot of people are losing people very close to them much sooner than they expected, or also in ways that mean that they can't get to them. They can't say goodbye. In many cases, they can't have a funeral or like the kind of funeral service that they'd like to have with family and friends all there. It occurred to me the other night, last night I think, that one of the ways I feel like I can help is that I have been some version of there. I have not been in this particular situation, and I don't want to pretend that I have been, but I wasn't able to get back to see my dad before he died. So I didn't see him before he died. I wasn't in the hospital room at all. I didn't go to the mortuary or anything. We were able to have a funeral for him, which now feels like an utter privilege, honestly, because I can't, like, my absolute love to anyone who's not been able to have a funeral for someone they lost who they love, because that must be really heartbreaking. But yeah, I feel like it has given me this kind of knowledge, and it's been interesting to see other people who've gone through grief. Like, I'm a member of various support groups now, and I follow a lot of Instagram accounts and that kind of thing, which I really recommend doing, and I wish I'd done sooner. We're sort of, many of us, saying like something about this feels really familiar. Because it's a loss on so many different levels. It's a loss of things that you wanted to do this year. It's a loss of sort of social experiences en masse in many ways. There are lots of different kinds of losses, some that feel really big and some that feel really small. But a very obvious one, of course, is that many people will be losing someone and going through the experience of losing someone and mourning within these strange situations. And grief can be extremely isolating. I found it really, really isolating. And I imagine it's going to be additionally isolating if you literally can't go and see your friends, if you can't go and sit on their sofa and bundle up in a blanket. Even though I made videos about grief on here in the years after my dad died, in many ways it's only been in the past few years that I've really, really started to like sit with the grief in a different way and encounter it in a different way. And the things that have always helped me through this period, especially as I didn't know other people who were going through it, were books, which is again not really a surprise to anyone. Just gonna dive in there, talk a little bit about each one, and I think in general I sort of, it gives me an impulse to make more videos about death and grief and this phase of it, whatever this means, whatever phase means, whatever it means. And I also want to like collect and organize the previous videos I've made about that. So if you have a particular video of mine that's really helped on the grief front, please let me know the title of it in comments and I'll put it in a playlist or something. Anyway, this is a lot of preamble. I think there's part of me that's like almost avoiding starting this. So the first book I think I've actually spoken about on here before many years ago. This was one of my texts for Religions of Asia, a class that I took when I was studying abroad at Vassar College in 2010. And that was the year, like the months preceding my dad's death. So it happened to be around at this time, and I'm so grateful that it was. It's a Buddhist text by the Vietnamese monk Thich Nhat Hanh. And I learned so much from it in my class, and then I read it over and over again, in part because it's so short. It's 50 pages, and I find when I'm really overwhelmed, when I'm feeling a lot, when I don't even know what I'm feeling, when I can't even access that part of my brain even, or that part of my body, it's very difficult to read. And I've turned to this not only in moments of grief, but in other moments of different kinds of loss or different kinds of struggle. It talks a lot about interconnectedness. It just asks you to consider every object around you, consider yourself in the context of them, to consider such things at a time when there is a global connection with all of this. There is a sense of strange unity that's come from this. There's a not entirely equal playing field, of course there's not. People have access to different kinds of care and different kinds of testing even, and different places where they're self-isolating and different levels of ability to do that. But there is such an awareness of connectedness right now. And I think the grief support groups that I've been to and other people I've spoken to about losing a parent or just losing someone significant in your life, there's a different kind of connection that comes through that too. So I think this helps me on like a really in the middle of panic, need something meditative to slow down my thoughts and also just make me feel like I'm part of this world. But it also, I think, is great on a sort of metatextual level of speaking to the moment that we're in, and also of the moment that you find yourself in when you really properly connect with someone and feel comfortable connecting with someone, being in that space of vulnerability about grief and loss, which again, I really encourage you to do. It's been like the most rewarding thing, one of the most rewarding things of my life. My second recommendation is the third of a trilogy, and I think you should read the entire trilogy. It's the His Dark Materials trilogy, and the third book is The Amber Spyglass. If you don't know the story of His Dark Materials, it is a version of a kind of Paradise Lost full kind of story that plays with huge biblical themes and operates in different universes, in different worlds. And you follow two main characters, Lyra and Will, but then also this whole ensemble cast of characters. My relationship to so many of those characters has changed so much over the years. I have to say, like when I reread this most recently, there were characters I connected with and for whom I felt empathy, who I didn't really expect to. I definitely noticed my perspective on everything changing. There's also been a BBC adaptation of the first book so far, of Northern Lights, that also made me look at the characters in different ways. All three books very much deal with loss and death and grief, but there is a real interrogation of it in the third book, a real play with it as well. It explored not only what people refer to as like different stages of grief, which I found to be a complete muddle and happen in all sorts of ups and downs and backs and forths and never linear, but also in how we talk about grief and how we talk about loss in our different cultures, and how we can also have some kind of agency over how we tell that story, and the way that story interweaves with loss and with grief and with remembering. I mean, also for me, because I was brought up Roman Catholic, reading the His Dark Materials books made me so aware of the stories I was told about myself and about goodness and evil and so on, but also about death. Yeah, also about what death means and how we imagine death and how we imagine people who've died. I think Philip Pullman is always brilliant about talking about story in how he writes about story. Whenever I picture him, I almost imagine him weaving, because he just weaves all these themes so carefully and beautifully, and so like there's so much in it, there's like such a glorious density to it. Every single page is full of different universes, and it's such a brilliant allusion to life and death and storytelling and different kinds of survival, you know, like not necessarily literal survival, but how we again on a broader scale keep going, but not dismissing the importance of closer interactions too. And if you haven't read them before, the third book will also just make you cry. My next recommendation is We Were Liars by E. Lockhart, which for me really helped me understand the sort of traumatized responses I had, impulses I had, and like, and sort of the chaotic experience of it, I suppose, and the fact that it does become a before and after moment. It is this significant thing that has changed the world. And what's interesting about this particular moment again is that you have this world-changing thing at the same time that the world is so aware of having changed. It might feel difficult for you to grieve at a time when there is this big scale destruction, like whether or not you lose someone related to COVID-19. There is a sense of like, well, you know, this is just one loss and there have been so many losses. I'd encourage you to be really kind to yourself about that, because your loss is important and the person you've lost is important in your life, especially if you're like watching this video. Like, it is okay to grieve, you're allowed to grieve, which is something that my Spanish teacher said to me in year 9, and I think of all the time. You're allowed to grieve. regardless of what's going on in the world. Still, it can be separating. You can think of yourself in a different place from other people and just be very aware, I think, of not being able to get out of your own head. A lot of my giving away books and kind of living with less came after my dad died, and in part after going through all of his things and just being aware of how much is left behind and how you can't take any of it with you. And there were like healthy and unhealthy responses to that, I'll say. I was looking for that without really knowing I was looking for it in the books that I was reading, but they always seem to come down firmly on one side of it. And one thing that I really love about We Were Liars is that it doesn't come down firmly on one side of anything. Sometimes I feel like, should I really properly go through the plot of these books? Instead, I'm just gonna tell you what they mean to me. You'll probably have heard of this book, and you will definitely have heard of its author, but this is still one of my favorite books of all time. And taught me about grief and continues to teach me about grief whenever I get back to it. And that book is Looking for Alaska by John Green, which is a boarding school novel. It explores grief and guilt really well. Again, that sense of like apathy that can sometimes come after you lose someone. All the different kinds of responses that you have to lose someone, have to losing someone. Everyone responding to things differently and everything changing dramatically, and the things that you can do for each other and things people can teach you about grief. You don't always get an answer and things aren't always clear cut. You don't even understand often why you acted the way you did. And I think that that's particularly poignant for people who may not have had a sort of full stop ending, which again isn't exclusive to the situation we're in right now. I know a lot of people who've lost people close to them very suddenly, but I think it's more likely right now. Yeah, I think people will be looking for a kind of closure that may be very difficult to find in the traditional places, and the places where you get some level of that closure, like a funeral or even just by being in the hospital room. And heartbreakingly, that's not been possible for people right now. So ambiguity, this is a really good one for that. It's such a comfort to me still when I read it. This book has been with me now for 14 years. It feels like it's living alongside me in many ways. A Heartbreaking Work of Staggering Genius was one of the first books that I read after my dad died. I think it was maybe the first year or so. Got it from a charity shop, and I'd seen it in charity shops all the time, but I'd not really ever known what it was about. And I bought it and read it and completely fell in love with it, and also felt like it was the book that I really needed at that time. And there were so many pages that I like dog-eared and just thought like, oh yes, that's the feeling. This was one of the first books that I read after my dad died that gave me that sense over and over again of, yes, that's what I feel. The protagonist loses his parents to cancer, then has to look after his brother. The grief and the loss there, yeah, it just felt so aligned to what I was feeling. I also see now that I wrote little notes in it, and I think this is a really particularly good one for reading soon after a loss, as well as later on, because it felt very immediate. The next book is a book my friend Savannah wrote called The Truth About Keeping Secrets, and this is a YA novel about a girl, Sydney, who loses her dad and is pretty convinced that he's been killed, but everyone else in the town thinks that she's being really paranoid. There were so many moments in this book that really made me, like, transported me back to what like the first few months were like, what the first year was like, these key points in time like Christmas and so on that were really, really hard. And in even more than like the literal events of what happened, because again they were quite different, it's like there's so much truth in the emotional language of it, and again the isolation of it and not quite cutting through, and then you meet people who do cut through a bit more, and again people who have different relationships with the person that you lost, and you sort of have to live in this world where all these realities are true at once and you don't even feel like your feet are on the ground. So this, I think, did that so beautifully. I think I sent Savannah like a 3-paragraph message after I read it. I was so overcome with it, and I still go back to it, and it came out I think last year, so it's not even been out that long. I really loved it, and for me I think it really helps me get in touch with that emotional period when I need to, while also having this mystery storyline to it, and also looking at how we process those feelings that are maybe quite uncomfortable or new or scary, or those grieving feelings, and things that we can do to cope, which sometimes might not always be necessarily the healthiest things, but you need something. You feel like you need something to help you cope, and it looks at different things you can turn to in that context. And also about connecting with people in grief. This is one that I feel like a lot of British people in particular will recognise, Everything I Know About Love by Dolly Alderton. One of my unexpected favourite books for the last few years. It was everywhere, it was every single table, and I became such a snob about it even though I hadn't read it, and I don't like it when people do this. And then I read it and I loved it and I cried so hard and I felt so seen by it. This is a memoir by Dolly Alderton, and it's about growing up on the outskirts of London and always looking in, always trying to go in, always trying to be more central, about her group of friends and their dynamic, and the various kind of losses and loves and the sort of fantasy romances with guys and these kind of short-lived relationships with them, or and this sense that like you're doing it wrong, she's doing it wrong, and everyone else has got it figured out. But it also talks about grief, and it talks about so many things that just were such close parallels to my life, and I think in that sense it is a big part of why it means a lot to me. But I don't think you need to literally have grown up in Greater London to connect with this book. The grief element to it really took me by surprise. A Grief Observed by C.S. Lewis is one of like the classic grief recommendations. It is very short. It is 61 pages. So again, good to read straight after if your brain can't quite process a lot of text, but good to read anytime. And it's C.S. Lewis writing about reflections right after his wife died. And yes, this is very widely recommended. I think John first recommended this to me a long time ago. And I believe it was one of the first books I bought again, like maybe in the first like month after my dad died, because it felt like I needed things that would help me cope. So I bought this, I bought The Year of Magical Thinking, which was another really helpful one, and is often recommended. I don't have a copy with me right now, but like that was another one that I found very helpful. It's just very, yeah, very raw, very honest, and there's an immediacy to it. And the way that he so brilliantly and beautifully chooses language and words to talk about what he's going through, I think gave a lot of language to what I was feeling. And even just metaphors that were helpful, like just any words in this big void of not feeling anything was helpful. And it felt like he was sitting beside me too. Like all of these books have felt like companions in different parts of my life. But maybe different ports of my life is also a way to think about it. Like I'm this big ship and I'm arriving at different stations, and I don't know who's going to be there. And sometimes on the ship there's also this other guest called Grief, and I feel like I'm all alone on this big ship with Grief. And then we stop at a port and someone else comes aboard and says, have you thought about this? Maybe let's look at it this way. Even saying that made me emotional. Another one that's recently widely recommended is Grief is the Thing with Feathers. This is by Max Porter, and this is about some boys who lose their mother, and they are visited by Crow. And it's absurd in a lot of ways, but it's really, really beautiful. It's sort of in poem form. I was kind of pushing it away when I first read it because everyone told me, oh, have you read this? Have you read that? And a lot of the people who were telling me about, like, oh, have you read Grief? There's a Thing with Feathers, were people who hadn't lost anyone super close to them. And I felt, I think, a bit resentful of that, because I was like, you don't get to tell me what's going to help me. Wow, classic Rosianna. Super stubborn. But then I read it and I was like, oh, the second time I read it, I was able to let that sort of go in many ways and read it, and and felt very, again, very connected to it, but also just interested in ways that writing about grief changes and fractures form, and how that can be expressed. When I read more recently that I spoke about in a video, I think, was How to Write an Autobiographical Novel by Alexander Chee, which is a book of lots of different essays. But there are a couple, especially Rosary, in here that spoke to my experience of grief so directly. And Alexander Chee lost his dad when he was a teenager. So that grief and that loss is woven into all those stories. But then there's also the AIDS crisis. The grief is threaded through every part of the story, of the essays rather. It's like in the background or in the foreground, it's there. That was helpful for me too, because it's not like the loss is only present when you're talking about it directly or specifically, like the loss is always present. It's like when, you know, they say in all those books, like, don't worry about mentioning that my person has died, because I know, like, I haven't forgotten. It is not possible for me to forget it. And then there are some others that I don't have on me right now. There's lots of others. Wild by Sheryl Strayed, which is stunning. And I've read several times, actually. It's also very healing. Allowed me to look at sort of some of the messy, less neat decisions I'd made and without shame and without judgment. And there's something very cathartic about that book for me. And the film, too. But the book in particular. Option B by Adam Grant and Sheryl Sandberg was helpful to me in terms of like specific strategies to cope with grief and just being quite practical about it, but also incorporating lots of different people's experiences about it as well. Honestly, rereading Hamlet, which is what I did a lot after my dad died and also a lot before my dad died, was really helpful to me because there's just the grief and the loss there. Then you have this storyline that is allowed to be a tragedy. A lot of the books I choose for Life's Library, like A Field Guide to Getting Lost and like The Summer Book and so on, explore grief in different ways and loss in different ways, because that's the book, those are the books that I'm most drawn to. As I say, like, once you lose someone really close to you, you can't undo that. It becomes part of the fabric of your all of your experience. So when books don't have that presence, like, sometimes I'm a bit like, all right, I can't. Sometimes it can be hard to find my way into it. And then, of course, like Harry Potter. When I first reread Harry Potter after my dad died, like, it just fundamentally changed. Like, the text shifted. There's just a few of them. I can make a part two if I remember more of them. I also want to talk about grief in films and TV shows, because that's another place where I feel like, processed a lot of what I've felt, a lot of what I've experienced. As always, if there are any other sort of topics on this theme that you would like me to talk about, I'm happy to. I think more than ever it's important to remove any shame from talking about grief and loss. This is a time of huge loss and of really broad-ranging grief, but again, I just want to repeat that you're allowed to grieve, even and especially in this context. You're really, honestly allowed to grieve. So I'm going to leave it there for now, and I'll see you soon. I'm just going to wear pajamas every time, so you can see the full range of my pajama collection, which is mostly just like t-shirts that I also sleep in. Okay, goodbye.